is unrecorded. A lot of times we'd be on the road and things would just collide in a way where unpredictably we'd reach some sort of pinnacle that was just absolutely astounding, and we would just all look at each other and think, wouldn't it be great if someone was recording this?
Freddie was, you know, a brilliant musician in every way. He was a genius of melodic invention. He's just a complete musician.
I don't think that anyone before or even after will ever play the trumpet the way Freddie Hubbard played.
Freddie was a kind of a musical intuitive and mystic in a certain way, and he really channeled something from somewhere else, I think.
Man, Freddie was like, you know, I should make a movie about him, you know, because he was one of the most complex people.
He was a very demanding employer. Every night you were forced to play at the absolute peak of what you could do. He used to always say, well, you guys got your bachelor's at school, you're getting your master's with me. Keystone Korner was the center of jazz in San Francisco.
There was something to me magical about the Keystone. Todd Barkan ran it, and Todd was, how should I put it?
He was a character. Central casting couldn't have done any better. He was the jazz club owner.
He was very relaxed. He would let whatever the musicians wanted, you know.
Todd would introduce the band individually and bring them up, you know. It was a jazz club, you know. People were there to hear the music, for sure. I mean, it wasn't just like some clubs you go in and you know, people are talking, and the music is in a backdrop, you know. No, they were there to hear the music at Keystone.
Freddie was like two people, just two distinct personalities, really. One of those personalities was the most generous, gentle, and giving kind of mentor type guys musically. He expected you to play at the peak of what you could do, and if you didn't, he could really turn into quite a monster. There were certain times that you just wanted to become invisible.
He could get mean, but talking to him, he was a very sensitive, intelligent person who at the bottom of it was a nice person.
Even though Freddie's been called arrogant, and sometimes it applied, there was this other side to Freddie that it was a almost insecure side. He felt like he had to prove himself. That's why he ended up being so great, because he was never satisfied. Because he also didn't feel like people liked him as a musician. He would say that often. There was another thing that was puzzling to me. I don't think they really like me. I don't think they like what I'm playing. I said, come on, Hub, man. How could they not like that?
One song that is contained in this record that I don't believe I've ever seen Freddie having recorded before is Giant Steps, and that's a song that he used to call from time to time as a test of sorts for himself and in some situation or another, and you know, kind of, okay, let's show everybody that I can play on trumpet with what most people can't play on sax, you know. You know, there was a certain amount of bravado and sort of the need to make it clear that he was the cat.
The collection of songs that we did on Pinnacle is a really great choice of tunes. The thing I like about it is that it's true improvisation.
Well, you know, this band that Freddie put together was actually a real good mix of guys. And we had developed a blend, you know, that's not easy to attain, but it comes from just playing together. That year, I believe we played Keystone maybe two or three times. Freddie was definitely at the top of his game, but the really strong point is the uniform sound that the band had.
There's some beautiful playing and some examples, I think, of the level where technique and impressive technical ability meet head-to-head with lyricism and poetry. And he's playing at that level on this stuff.